So, is my mic on? Hello?
Yes, sir. Your mic is on.
Okay. So, you can hear me in the hall?
Yeah. You are audible, Vikram.
So, soft indication for rectal US of perianal fistulas and abscesses. Main purpose in practice to see the anatomy and also define the anal pathology. The patient is not sedated. I have covered him well. He wanted a non-sedated procedure. In my practice, I prepare with PEGLEC, like a full colonoscopy. Always I proceed with a rectal examination for obvious reasons. A sigmoidoscopy oblique a colonoscopy for white light evaluation. Evaluate endoscopically the anal verge, the perianal skin, the anal canal, the lower half, the upper half, and the rectum till the sigmoid at a minimum. Now, rectal US has actually evolved from saying that you cannot distinguish right from left. We now actually, if you saw our earlier demonstrations, even when we went from the oral side, we could reach the aortic bifurcation. And now even when we go from the caudate side, we can reach the bifurcation of the aorta. So we usually plan to reach the L4 level. And can someone point out, please, the arrow? So with the arrow, I have a help here. So we have one vessel here on which the arrow is, and we have a second vessel here on which the arrow is, and there is an echogenic spine behind these vessels. Can you appreciate this? Hello?
Yes, we can appreciate.
Yes, so the importance of this is that if you are staging rectal cancers, you have nodes here, they make it M1A. These are metastatic sites of nodal disease. And therefore, if you are doing a study of most or any rectal pathology, I at least make an attempt to go this eye. I may not in individual cases, but I prepare the bowel well. I like to aspirate all the air, flatten out the folds with water instillation. It's an underwater advancement of the scope, and also inflate the balloon so as to slip over the folds of the rectum. Now, to show you what is what, can I have a Doppler, please? It's okay. So these are vascular structures. Can you put a pulse Doppler over it? I'm sorry, this is very far off from this thing. So pulse on. That's okay. So that's the aorta off. Can you appreciate the aortic pulsations?
Yes, the peaks.
Now put it over the other big vessel to the right of it. And this is the cava. So now can I have the Doppler off? Can I have a full screen now? 360 please. No. So, can I have the orientation again back, please? Thank you. So, that's the orientation. Usually when you advance, you get to display these vessels in the right lower quadrant of the screen. That has the Doppler off, please. So, that has been my experience. And obviously now if you know that the aorta is to the left and the cava is on the right, you can appreciate that the scope is now coming from below, and it's the orientation is the reverse of what I was telling you in my lecture. When the scope is coming from oral, you are looking from below. Now the scope is coming from below and you are looking into the patient from above. So that's the right side of the patient. The right side of the screen is the right side of the patient, and the aorta to the left is the left side of the patient. So with this orientation now, I haven't seen this study and I'll see it along with you. We start to withdraw, and you can see I'll need some H flow on the vessels now. Some H flow. So you see the aorta has divided into the two iliacs. You can see the aortic division. Can you appreciate that?
Yes, it is divided.
So one out. This is the right common iliac, and the other one is the left common iliac. And the cava is still intact. If I withdraw a millimeter or so, you'll see the cava splitting up with into the right common iliac. Yes, that was the right. And the left common iliac, and this is the right common iliac artery. And then in EUS, in practical terms, it is most often the right sided vessels that you can trace, and as I withdraw they elongate. So now can you see, we now see the right iliac artery, please point it this, and you see the right common iliac vein on that side. In general in EUS, the artery is closer to you than the vein. And then you have the spine, which is seen in an elongated section behind it. Yes, so that's the spine. So now the image is elongating from a cross section, artery closer to you than the vein. And the importance here is that common iliac artery nodes here are also M1A designation. The vein you can see has split, and then the artery will also split. Can you see the bifurcation of the of the vein? And now you see the bifurcation of the artery. The configuration is like this, like the fingers of my hand. The external iliac artery and vein are anterior and lateral. The internal iliac artery and vein are posterior and medial. So that's the Y-shaped division, as I have started to call it. The internal nodes become regional lymph nodes. The external nodes become the metastatic nodes. So this finesse is of some practical importance. This is also the area where in future we may be doing hypogastric plexus block in pelvic metastasis or pelvic malignancies. So very briefly, this was for academic interest. I heard Malay telling you about this in the lecture, so I thought I'll show you. Is this clear, please?
Yes.
This there was some discussion about this in the lecture. This is not yet come out in the books. As we withdraw, you will see the artery also divide with the up and down. And then you can actually see the artery is now bifurcating into this V-shaped thing. The vessel that is closer to you, can you see?
Yes.
The smaller vessel away from you is the internal iliac, that's very right. And what is out is the external iliac, which will just go away. That's what Malay was telling you. Now we withdraw. And now you can have the Doppler off. Now I'm not interested in the vessels. You can have the Doppler off. Now can I have some water in the lumen? Can I have some water in the lumen? Is there an endoscopy assistant here, please? Put some water slowly. So we always like to displace the rectal wall a little bit away from the transducer by water instillation. More. Too much water will mobilize stool from above.
So too little. Don't use balloon?
I have a balloon. But I also want at the same time, since we were talking about perianal fistulas, fissures, I want to have a look at the rectal wall as we go by. So the idea of putting in water is to move the wall away from a transducer at a focal point. So now it is very simple. I just have to withdraw and wait for something to show up. I withdraw, 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 withdraw. This is above the peritoneal reflection. I withdraw. And now the first thing that should appear is the bladder, which you see here. And by this is the bladder. And by convention, we would rotate the image electronically. Please rotate to take the bladder at 12 o'clock. And you can see the spine at 6 o'clock, right opposite, the echogenic spine below. Yes, that's the stripe of the spine. And the bladder is above. So the patient here is a male patient. So we'll see the obvious structures. If I can bend forward, this is where we expect to see the ureter. This is possibly the ureter. Can you see the ureter?
Yes.
This is a little thin structure draining into the posterior and inferior aspect of the bladder. In females, this is crossed here by the uterine artery. The configuration is called bridge underwater. And now, as I withdraw, what on the side you see the side wall of the pelvis. This is the obturator internus forming this lateral wall of the pelvis, defining the lateral wall of the pelvis. The bladder on top. This is one of the few occasions where you actually use the small wheel of the EOS scope to center your probe in the lumen. Rotation or torque is not advisable. Now again, withdraw. And you see the seminal vesicles where they are being pointed out. Can you see those?
Yes, yes.
And I think Malay told you that these are located around 7 to 9 centimeter from the anal verge, and they are the sonographic landmark for peritoneal reflection, the anterior peritoneal reflection. So anything or any tumor that is above it is intraperitoneal, what is below it is extraperitoneal, and if you subdivide rectal tumors into T4A and B, this has significance. So on endoscopic image, it is the middle rectal wall. On sonography, it is the seminal vesicles. In females, it is the cervix. This is the mark of sonographic demarcation for the peritoneal reflection. Seminal vesicles can be very confusing for lymph nodes. So I have personally made mistake of aspirating these. These don't mistake them for lymph nodes. They look like mustache. What we also see behind a very hyperechoic fascia. Can you point out the fascia here? behind. Yes. So this is the Denon Villiers fascia. And on both the sides, this is the obturator internus and this is the mesorectum. I don't see the mesorectal fascia. I can see it in patients who are very fatty. So lateral sidewall pelvis, lateral sidewall pelvis, the semianal vesicles, the bladder base, and the Denon Villier fascia beginning below the level of peritoneal reflection. It is hanging down. I pull back, pull back, pull back. Center the probe very slowly. And now, everything of interest will now be anterior. And what do I see? I see the prostate. So can you mark the prostate? In practice, demarcating a prostatic cancer is very difficult. But you can see the median lobe and you can see the lateral lobe and you can see calcification in older people. This is possibly the urachus which you are pointing out. The prostatic urethra would be likely this. Can you make it a top half, please, of the screen? Can I have a gauze? Can I have a gauze? Thank you. So you see the prostate and you see the pubis in front. Okay, so that's the prostate. If I push it forward, you can see the bladder base and you can see the urethra. Can you point out the urethra? Urethra, yes, yeah, in the center. This one. See the bladder base going down into the prostate as the prostatic urethra. And now as I come down from the prostate, the urethra will move forward again into the penile or the bulbar urethra. Can you see that go forward? This is the urethra now, prostatic urethra as a hole in the center. And now this moves forward. Can you appreciate that?
Yes.
In the hall, am I clear, please?
Yes, yes, you are clear.
So you see the prostatic urethra and you see the bulbospongiosus again. Now, this one.
Only thing is too much of anatomy, so.
No, it's okay. So that's okay. So can I have a full screen now? At some time you'll encounter this in different patients. So as I come down now, we should start to see the puborectalis. And now we see the puborectalis, very nice white string, open like this, open in front, closed on back, forming the normal anorectal junction. And this is the demarcation between the rectum above and the anal canal below on EOS and also on finger palpation when you do a rectal examination. For this patient, in addition, we have not seen any supralevator extension of an abscess. But if you look very closely now with me at 9 o'clock position, can you see something? Here and here. Keep a watch here. You see certain things in the intersphincteric plane. I'll again have to bend forward. So where is the pointer? This is the formation of the internal sphincter. You see an abscess here. This is the puborectalis, which will form the external sphincter. So this is intersphincteric abscesses forming one here, possibly in continuity, which I am going to trace down. Okay, so far?
Yes.
Can you see the liquefied abscess below? You may enlarge it for once to show them. Can you see this abscess here?
Yes, now.
This is now becoming, this is a very important finding. I think we can show this better than MRI, whether it is an active abscess or it is just inflammation, particularly in the era of biologicals. In my practice, I would not use adalimumab or anything. If I see this kind of an abscess with a liquefied, even if it is very small, I would choose to wait, maybe give prolonged antibiotics. Some of these are sterile, but nonetheless, I don't think biologicals would be a very good idea in this patient. So as we come down, remember that the inner circular forms the internal sphincter and the outer longitudinal muscle of the rectum forms the median conjoint ligament in the intersphincteric plane, and the external sphincter is a skeletal muscle with which the puborectalis fuses. I think Malay told you all about it. So now I deflate the balloon completely. Now I'm in the anal canal. This is the upper third of the anal canal where you have the internal sphincter here. You now very nicely see three things. Can you freeze? So what you see here is the internal sphincter. the mucosa submucosa complex, the external sphincter, and very nicely you see a elongated intersphincteric abscess which is infralevator in location, and you see a posterior abscess possibly also communicating. Unfreeze please.
Vikram, why do you say intersphincteric?
Yes, because I just told you we were tracing the rectal walls from above. Can you make the camera focus on me rather than on the patients behind? Okay. So the inner circular continues as the internal sphincter, outer longitudinal cover continues as the median conjoint ligament, and the intersphincteric plane is the plane of the median conjoint ligament. So you have the internal sphincter, you have the external sphincter, and between it there is a virtual plane where you have the anal glands. And once there is a infection, perianal abscess, they originate in the anal glands, and therefore the first beginning is in the intersphincteric plane. Because the glands are located there and the ducts open into the anal valves. So this is, if I can convince you, is the elongated liquid abscess very nicely seen here.
Yes.
In the intersphincteric plane here. That's nicely seen, and also a midline posterior abscess. Look at the external sphincters now, sorry, from here to here. That's the skeletal muscle now, which we see. This is the area of the median conjoint ligament, which has this abscess and which has this abscess. It is looking more thick because it is expanded by edema and abscess. So this is the internal sphincter, this is the median conjoint ligament, this is the external sphincter. As I pull down, you can interrupt me in between, I'm sorry. Hello?
Yeah, very nice.
Okay. A little bit smaller. Okay, so this is the upper third of the anal canal. Now is the lower third, the middle third of the anal canal, where you see that the internal sphincter has formed. Can you show that? The internal sphincter is thick. The external sphincter is nearly complete. There is a posterior abscess, midline abscess. Can you see? No. It is trailing. And then there is a fistula possibly going there also. Here is an abscess, here is an abscess. And then as I come down to the lower third of the anal canal, you see the anterior ring of external sphincter is nicely formed anteriorly. And as I come down, you see that there is inflammation behind, and the area behind is you'll have to make it a bit smaller. Area behind is not continuous. This is the area of the anococcygeal ligament, but it is continuous in the presacral plane. So hello, any better? So that the abscess can track on both sides and form a horseshoe like abscess, but not in this patients. So you see some air inside. Can you see the air?
Yes, we can appreciate.
And can you see the fistula track? No, up. This one you can see, yes. So this is a intersphincteric fistula, very small one, intersphincteric abscess, intersphincteric fistula, a perianal abscess behind. This is outside the sphincter now. Everything infralevator, no supralevator. You see some air inside. Can you see that, please? Can you make it lower half? And can you make it big? Big. More big. Now you see the liquefied abscess with the air. And yes, I'll just show that. You see the fistula, external fistula now. Can you freeze now? So you see many interesting things here. You see the intersphincteric abscess. It has come out. There is air. And this is the external fistula track. Can you see this fistula track? In my practice, I would put a small infant feeding tube in this and instill water, or even some sonoview, and it will give me a very good B-mode enhancement. Unfreeze please. In real time, I think I am more comfortable demonstrating fistula tracts and anal anatomy with my own hands than relying on MRI, but yes, MRI is also very nice. So this is a reasonably convincing anatomy. Can you take me full circle now? Full circle, little bit smaller. So this is the middle third of the anal canal. The balloon is not getting deflated, but should be deflated. No, it is stuck, I can't help it. So as I come down, the internal sphincter vanishes, and now you have only a hyperechoic circle of external anal sphincter. This is the lower third of the anal canal, and little bit inside you will see the pathology which we were seeing, and now, no, that was not a pathology, so that was the extending, and now we are out. So doesn't take much time. I was speaking, otherwise these are 5 minutes job. The patient is awake and watching with me, and I don't think I caused him much discomfort, I hope. So any questions, please? It does give you information which helps in the treatment of these patients. So no steroids or biologicals from my side for this patient. Maybe some more antibiotics, and then this is a nice way to follow up these patients. He has doesn't have complex fistulas, doesn't need drainage or possibly seton. It's active inflammation. These fistulas should heal with maybe antibiotics for 3, 4, 6 weeks or so. So, any questions?
No, I think that's all, Vikram. We got 7 o'clock now.
Okay,
and
okay,
we have
okay.
Last panel discussion for around 30 minutes.
Okay, done. Thank 30 you. 30. Thank you.
So, doctor, so the thing is, we'll have to just organize 4 chairs.
Kafi kuch pata chal gaya tera, acche se
can we have the lights on?
Haan, pass hai, sir.
The lights on.